In this video, we talk about how factor models are used for risk management. Now, modern risk management firms like Barra MSCI provide risk management tools that build on the factor model logic. The underlying idea goes back to the CAPM, which derived that first total risk of an asset consists of systematic risk and undiversifiable idiosyncratic risk. And second, the idiosyncratic risk component converges to zero if that asset is part of a sufficiently large portfolio. Now, to formalize ideas, let's do the following. Assume that capital F is a matrix of excess returns with dimensions k times t. Since these excess returns are tradable, the market price of risk lambda is simply the expectation of F. Now, if the asset market follows a linear factor model with F as the factor premiums, then the expected risk premium of an asset I would coincide with the following expression. Now, realized risk premiums of asset I, they deviate from expectation. And here's what the realized risk premiums look like. They also consist of two components. Now, let's start with the second component, the epsilon IT. So epsilon IT is the idiosyncratic return innovation of asset I at time t. Let's go to the first component. Here Ft is the k times 1 column vector of realized factor premiums. So note, both epsilon IT and Ft minus the conditional expectation of Ft as of t minus 1 are unforecastable as of time t minus 1. So hence, these are two types of innovations. Epsilon IT is the idiosyncratic innovation to asset I's return, while Ft minus its expectation is the innovation to the factor premium, to the systematic factors. So innovations are also called news, meaning that unforecastable information arrived at time t, and asset markets reacted to that news immediately. And that's the reason why the realized returns differ from the expectations at time t minus 1. Now, formally, we can now write return innovations of asset I as follows. So note that factor risk Ft minus the conditional expectation of Ft as of t minus 1 is unpredictable as of t minus 1. The covariance of asset I's return with the factor premiums quantify asset I's risk contribution to the well-diversified portfolio. The ratio of epsilon IT's variance over the variance of RIT measures the reduction in asset I's risk when it's held in a well-diversified portfolio instead of a standalone investment. Now also note, there are specialized risk firms in the market that provide customers with time series data of all types of risk factors. So risk managers can use that information to decompose their portfolio risk into systematic and idiosyncratic risk. And systematic risk can further be decomposed into the contribution of each risk factor. Now, I also want to highlight that in its most general form, there are time indices on many of the above-mentioned quantities. For example, the market price of risk lambda is likely to be time varying, meaning it should really read lambda t minus 1 is defined to be the expectation of Ft as of t minus 1. Similarly, asset I's factor risk exposure, the beta, is likely also time varying, so it should really read beta I, t minus 1 is defined to be the covariance as of time t minus 1 over the variance as of t minus 1. So you see that the time variation in the beta arises from either stochastic volatility in the factor premiums, which is the sigma f, and or from a time varying correlation between asset I and the factor premiums. Now, measuring these conditional forecasts requires a good data and good econometrics and machine learning skills. So in order to keep notation at a minimum, I usually do not carry these time indices around when explaining the basic concepts. Now let's turn to another key application of linear factor models for risk management, and that is to compute the covariance matrix of a large asset universe. So prior to the use of factor models, the covariance matrix of returns was calculated using past data with the following expression, which says that the jkth element of the covariance matrix of asset returns was calculated by simply taking the sample covariance between asset j and asset k. Now, the problem is, it's a dimensionality problem. Now let's assume that k equals 1,000. So we have 1,000 assets. So we would have to estimate 500,500 entries in the covariance matrix. Now, while that estimate of the covariance matrix is unbiased, it has a very high variance. And that high variance reduces the precision of the estimates of each entry to the covariance matrix. Now, on the other hand, if you use linear factor models to calculate the covariance matrix of returns, you will have to estimate sufficiently less parameters. So let's have a look what the estimate of the covariance matrix looks like for the linear factor model. It consists of two components. One is the beta transpose sigma f beta, and the other one is the sigma eta. So first note that the betas, or the beta hat, that's a generalized least squares estimate for the factor exposure matrix. It's determined by projecting time series return data onto realized factor premiums. Now, sigma hat f is an estimate of the low dimensional factor risk premium panel. So it characterizes the covariance matrix of the factor premiums. And sigma hat eta is a diagonal matrix of idiosyncratic risks. One way to compute that sigma eta matrix is to do the following, where, for example, epsilon hat 1 square GLS is the squared residual from regressing the return of asset 1 onto all k risk factor premiums. The linear factor estimate to the covariance matrix of returns is biased. That's a bad thing. But it has a lower variance and ergo a higher precision than the sample covariance matrix, which is a good thing. Now remember, the linear factor model estimate for the covariance matrix is accurate if all correlations between two assets arise from exposure to a common risk factor, or to a set of common risk factors. Meaning, if we can write, like in the next equation, that the covariance between return J and M really arises from that common exposure to F. Now, the takeaway is that risk managers have to first incorporate all relevant systematic risk factors. Second, use a proper statistical model for their time series dynamics. And third, ensure that the resulting residuals are indeed uncorrelated across assets. Making a mistake in one of these three steps is likely to lead to wrong estimates of the covariance matrix. Now let's put some numbers on the table to make it more tangible. For 1,000 assets and 10 risk factors, one needs 11,055 estimates to pin down the 1,000 times 1,000 return covariance matrix. Now that's a lot, but it is still factor 50 lower compared to the sample covariance matrix. And the breakdown would be as follows. You need 1,000 estimates for firm-specific risk. You need 55 estimates for the sample covariance matrix of factor risk premiums. And finally, you need 10,000 estimates for beta.
Got feedback? We would love to hear it. Please drop us a line. And if you liked the video, give it a thumbs up. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel.